I forgot to turn this on. Welcome back, everyone. So today we are going to flip this usual setup and have you be the speakers. And I'm going to be sitting in my chair here on the beach, enjoying all of this cool research that you all will be talking about. So I guess for format, should we do a random order poll? How should we do this? Do we have people that want to go first?
I mean, I don't mind going if you just want someone to go.
Okay, we can go in any order people want. So, let's keep this to about 5 minutes or so that we can have a conversation. Hopefully you will all tell us about, you know, obviously the research questions you're planning on answering, but also, you know, how you've selected those research questions. Like why are those questions important? Why is it important that we know the answer to those questions? What's the knowledge gap and what's the hook? Who cares about answering those questions? What's the implication of that? And so, you know, I want to see that these studies are well motivated. I was just giving some feedback to some junior people reviewing research papers for a conference. And so that's one of the things that I saw there as well, that not much attention being paid to, you know, why people were doing the studies they were doing. And so I saw the reviewers kind of not picking up on that as much. And I think that's maybe the most important thing. There should be a good reason for doing studies, not just because you can. So I want to see all of these in your talks today. All right, so let's get this going. You should be able to share. Is that true?
Yeah, let me try.
You should be able to share. So we'll start with Jeremy, and I guess I will announce the next speaker while Jeremy is presenting so they could get ready. I'll use the chat for that.
All right, I'll kick it off. My project proposal has a lot to do with my research. I would like to do a study on the understandability of decompiler output. So the first thing I'd like to start with is this idea of reverse engineering, which is the whole motivation behind a decompiler in the first place. So reverse engineers, they take binaries that are out in the wild, whether it be like a library by a company that needs to be audited, or say a virus they found in the wild, and they try to figure out how it works. And it's really as simple as that. The problem here is that binaries are really tough to read as a human. It's technically possible, but I wouldn't recommend doing it directly. Typically, reverse engineers use a tool like this. This is IDA, it's called. On the left, we have what's called a disassembly, where it takes the raw bytes of a binary and it converts them into a sequence of instructions. IDA does this really nice thing where it also lays it out in little blocks for you, so it's easier to follow around. But what I'm actually interested in is the output on the right here. This is a decompiler plugin to IDA. And what it does is it takes the assembled output and it outputs this instead. This is like a really high level representation of the same code, but it abstracts a lot of the things out, so you don't need to manually like reconstruct for loops in your head, for example. So it makes it a lot easier to understand what's going on at a low level here. But there's a huge problem with this, and that is, although decompilers are really good at rebuilding the structure of a program, like for loops and if statements and things like this, they're really bad at rebuilding things that you can't just compute. So things like comments and variable names and custom types and things like that. And this is because the compiler, while a program is being transformed from a high-level language down to a low, down to this bytecode, it throws away all this information that's really useful, like comments it'll throw out, loop constructs. In this case, we have a while and a for loop, and these two loops actually compile to the same exact bytecode, so you can't even know what kind of loop was used in the original. But they also throw out variable names and user-defined types. So what you'll have, and these are the things that I focus on in my research. And these are the most recent things that I've made. So what you'll have is like, for example, on the left here, say you have this input code, you have this really nice structure that represents a 2D point with X's and Y's. And this function here, it computes the distance between two points in space. And it's really easy to read. You take a point one and a point two, and you take the difference, the square root of, or you square the distance between their X's, you square the distance between their Y's, and then you take the square root of that and you return it. But after it's compiled and decompiled, the decompiler doesn't recover the structure at all. So you don't even know that these two pieces of information are related at all. This takes a pointer to an int, so this might be like an array of integers as an argument. And you can see it does this weird dereferencing thing where it dereferences the pointer to get the first element, which is actually the X here. And it uses an array dereference to get the second element. And this is sort of confusing and hard to read. And also you can see it doesn't recover variable names at all. So what I've done and what my coworkers have done have created tools to take this right-hand side as input and try to predict the left-hand side by assigning types and variable names. And right now, the way that we're measuring the performance of this is just accuracy, just how much the output agrees with whatever the developer originally wrote. But it's pretty obvious that there might be a problem here with that. We would like to instead see how this affects humans' performance rather than how much we agree with whatever was originally typed in. And the reason for this is we have this theory that the variable names and types provide useful information about the purpose of variables. And this makes code easier to understand. This is the theory that we are operating under. And we really want the output of a decompiler to be easier to understand. I've talked with people with reverse engineers that we collaborate with, and what they really want to do is lower the bar to entry to make it easier for novices to understand the output of decompilers so that they could start helping do this work. So I have a couple of research questions that I'd like to answer. I'd like to know if variable names and types actually make code easier to understand. We already have some evidence on this in the literature, but it's not entirely clear that it also transfers over to decompiler output. Intuitively it does, but we're not terribly certain. And we also want to know, does making this code easier to understand help reverse engineers be better at their jobs, or even lower the bar so that other people can do this job of reverse engineering? I would like to do a study. We have a lot of people at the Software Engineering Institute next door who would be really interested in trying out our tools and playing with them. And I had tried things in the past with like trying to have people that we recruited on, say, Mechanical Turk or the student body try to do tasks to see how they perform. But we found that it might be more informative if we could actually talk to people who do this reverse engineering work in the field. So I'd like to give people at the SEI our tool, have them use it for a bit with some guidance, and then conduct semi-structured interviews to get information about their experiences, maybe dig deeper into the answers to these questions and understand more about what they do. And that is what I have prepared here. I'd be actually really open to any questions. It would be really nice to get any feedback.
Cool, thanks, Jer. What do you think about the design here, the study design? You don't all have to go at once. You could take turns.
I will say that personally, I have thought about this a bit. And I actually floated a few ideas around, like surveys and things like that. But just in my experience, having talked to these people, they always come up with things that I never thought of asking before. So I kind of want to avoid that pitfall.
So in terms of the scientists that would be using this tool, would they be using it on similar programs, or are they all working on different programs?
This is another thing that I sort of have that I'm not sure of. I would like them to emulate their current job as much as possible to do what they do, since these are the, this is the job that we're targeting. So they're typically working with, say, viruses found in the wild. This is not the only use case of a decompiler. Other people use it for things like reverse engineering legacy code to generate new patches and things like that. So there are other uses, but I think I would need to focus on one specific use case in this study.
Can you say something about how the data you'll be collecting through these interviews helps with the specific research questions that you had?
The questions about, yeah, I was trying to figure that out exactly. So I have a bit of trouble with this understandability idea. Because I think reverse engineers might have a slightly different idea of what understandable means than me. A lot of the times they're just trying to do something like identify quickly if this code belongs to some library so that we don't need to look at it because we don't need to understand what it does. And so sort of annotating this with variable names that suggest that it has some overall purpose might be really useful, even if they don't help them understand exactly what a piece of code does, mostly just what its role is. So I think the open-ended nature of a semi-structured interview would help get at the, would help refine the questions even.
No, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. If I remember correctly, you said in the beginning that you were interested in reducing the barriers to entry
on
like decompilers, but it seems like the study design is focused more on experts inside of the field or that are like well aware with decompilers. So I'm wondering if you may want to, I guess, focus your research question based off of, it seems like your study design is more focusing on experts for now instead of like those that are not as well trained in decompilers. So I'm wondering if should you make that explicit in the research question, or should you do like a separate study with non-trained individuals?
Yeah, this is actually a really good point because I've had the feedback from them before that we might be better served by studying novices, which is sort of the opposite thing that you hear most of the time when you're submitting papers, for example. You only surveyed students, and they suggested, hey, you might not want to survey us, you might want to survey students. But I think it would be useful to, at least in a preliminary study, to get feedback directly from them on what is slightly useful, what is extremely useful, what is completely useless. Because without doing the job constantly all day, every day, I'm not even certain what might be relevant to their job.
All right, thanks, Jeremy.
Yeah.
Austin?
How do I stop it?
Perfect. Okay. So I am going to look at cyber deception techniques. So the background for this is that deception has been used in warfare and conflict in general for a really long time, and it's considered an important piece of strategic calculations, particularly for offensive strategy, but also to an extent in defensive strategy. And that's true on the offensive side for cyber conflict, cyber warfare as well. But it's not entirely clear how useful deception techniques are on the defensive side for cyber. So there are some defensive deception tools available, used in practice, but it's not entirely clear how often they're used and whether or not they're really worth it. So that's what I'm going to try to get at with my study. So my theory is that deception tactics are not worth the investment in time, money, expertise, especially when you compare that to other defensive techniques. Given that defenders have a limited budget, limited resources, they have to choose, you know, one or the other. So I think that other defensive tools will be more useful. And the reasoning for this is that the reason deception works in general is because defenders can counterattack from, you know, picture defenders hiding in the bushes, can jump out, surprise, counterattack. But you can't really do counterattack with cyber for a lot of reasons, not at that tactical level. So since we can't counterattack from a defensive position, there's not really much cost to an attacker. So they'll just keep attacking regardless of the deception techniques. So the specific research questions that I have are, first of all, what is the benefit of using cyber deception? Is that greater than the cost of implementing it? Is the overall benefit of cyber deception greater than the overall benefit of other cyber defense techniques? And then are the answers to those two questions consistent across different combinations of cyber attackers and cyber defenders? I would assume that deception techniques are more effective for less skilled attackers than they are against more skilled, like nation state actors that are highly motivated. The metrics that I think I will be using for those is, first of all, just the monetary cost of implementing different types of defensive tools, then the time spent implementing and maintaining those tools, which translates to monetary cost. The time to detection of an adversary on a network, which is a common metric for cybersecurity. And then also intelligence that's collected using those deception techniques to watch adversaries. And then on the offensive side, the attack success rate, how that changes depending on what tools you have in place, the total time it takes for an attacker to succeed during an attack, and then the attack abandonment rate. So whether attackers get frustrated or confused and just give up, how often does that happen? So the study design, the main component of it is actually a game theory analysis and then a simulation built on that model. But the more relevant piece for this class is a survey and human subject experiment. There's not a lot of empirical data for this kind of thing with cybersecurity. So I need to be able to do the survey and experiment in order to help validate the model, get a sense of what the correct inputs are into that game theory model. So the very high level plan is online survey targeting defensive practitioners, distributed via LinkedIn, Twitter, whatever else seems appropriate. And then the human subjects experiments would be conducted using one of the Software Engineering Institute's existing training platforms. Obviously, we need to carefully think through the design of that in order to get to the research question specifics. As far as the data analysis, this is going to be mainly quantitative because I'm looking at cost estimates, number of tools deployed, that sort of thing. Human cognition and behavior is out of scope. There is some literature on that. So I'm not dealing as much with that since I'm doing the cost-benefit analysis. There is a bunch of related work in this area, but none of it is getting at whether deception is worth it. It's all looking at whether or not it works, so to speak, whether or not it actually deceives. But I wasn't able to find anything regarding a cost-benefit type of analysis. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Thoughts? One thing for me, while people are thinking about questions, I like this a lot. I found it a bit abstract. I wish you had given a few examples of sort of what you mean by deception tools or tactics or mechanisms or something to make this a little bit more relatable.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Yeah, I wasn't sure how far into detail or what people's backgrounds were on this. I think the short answer to that is there are tools available. The common ones are called honeypots, and they're basically little decoys that you put on the network that kind of look like other machines on the network. They're designed to either distract or frustrate or confuse attackers, slow them down, that sort of thing. But like I said in the beginning, it's not clear how many companies, organizations actually deploy them, how effective they are, and there's not a lot of research on it that I could find.
Are you worried about people being truthful and their answers to whatever, say, surveys you might run, given sort of the sensitive nature of the information you're looking to collect?
Yeah, that's kind of a constant battle. That's one of the reasons there's not a lot of empirical data in this area. I'm hoping that the method of online survey that people can opt into will help with that, and obviously back that up with an IRB statement that this is anonymous, the data is handled carefully, that sort of thing. And I think in addition to that, if I go through the right channels, using kind of the professional network that I have and that my colleagues have, I think maybe that will help alleviate at least a little bit of that.
Is there any risk that, like, I guess the current state of like these defensive deception tools, like maybe the costs are associated with the like businesses that are offering those right now, and those like could reasonably change over time? So
yeah, it's a good question. So there's a wide range of these tools, ranging from open source, do whatever you can with them, to pay us $10,000 a year and we'll do it for you. That's one of the reasons that I want to use the metric of time for maintenance and implementation. I think that will, then I can just compare across time rather than comparing monetarily, which still gets out the cost benefit ratio, just as a different metric.
All right, thanks a lot. Yeah, this was good.
Thanks.
Sam, maybe next.
Okay, I will go next. Okay, so the project I chose to do is the diversity innovation paradox in open source software, and what this means is, so first of all, this is a project that's a continuation from the mining software repositories hackathon that we did late last year. We're still continuing to work on that. So we made a little bit of progress, basically collecting. So we have already collect part of the data, but it's only a very small portion, and we will be collecting more data, and we haven't gone into the analysis yet. But the idea is, this idea of diversity innovation paradox is introduced by Hofstra et al. In their paper about this paradox in the general scientific community. And what it means is that, so there are two parts of it. One part is that they find that diversity breeds innovation. So more diverse groups of people, more diverse groups of scientific researchers working together tend to produce more innovations in their publications. And then the other thing they found is that on the other hand, some underrepresented groups or minority groups in these diverse minority groups of people in these diverse groups of community, these diverse groups of researchers tend to have a less successful career than those other majority in the same groups, right? So basically what we want to do is to see if there's similar effects of this paradox in the open source software community, in the open source software, for the open source software contributors. So our main research questions are, first of all, how do we define and measure the innovations in the context of open source software. And then the second one, the next step would be whether we want to see whether contributors in more diverse groups tend to produce more innovations by our definition in open source projects. And then finally, whether contributing more innovations may lead to a longer open source engagement, or whether actually for different, for example, for the minority or for the majority groups, that will have a different impact. And so, the goal or the objective, ultimate goal is to see how do we better sustain open source participation, right? Especially for minority groups. And the background on that is, so first of all, open source software is now really widespread, ubiquitous, and they are in many areas they are the key to a lot of modern day software, to the digital infrastructure of the society. And on the other hand, we also have prior work by Bogdan and many other researchers to show that diversity is a good indicator of basically open source productivity in this area. So basically more diverse groups do tend to produce better software. But the sort of the knowledge gap is that we don't have a good grasp of how groups of diverse contributors produce innovative software, and how this software innovation may lead to sustained participation or the career of these contributors in the open source area. So the benefit of what we do would be that we want to find whether this particular dimension of the of this open source community of producing innovative software by diverse groups, whether that may be a somehow correlated to their the people's engagement, a sustained engagement in the open source community. And we also want to find whether that can indicate how we can maintain and better produce innovative software. So the overall plan of the study is, first of all, we want to collect a lot of data. We want to collect open source innovation data. And then we will also need to collect some diversity data. We already have part of the data from a prior work, but we want to collect more data, especially on the tenure diversity for the contributors who have produced some innovations. And we also need to collect some sort of career information of these contributors. So basically how long they have participated or contributed to the open source projects, and how many contributions they have. And then after that, we will do some statistical analysis, most likely regression on the data we collect and to see if there's any potential correlations. So to collect the innovations data. So first of all, in the paper that we referenced, Hostrup et al., they define the scientific innovations as the first co-occurrence of two concepts. One very prominent example they gave was that before 1987, so people knew about HIV, the virus. But the concept of HIV is only seen in the scientific publications of, for example, virology, while the mentioning of the monkey, the particular animal monkey, is only present in another set of publications, for example, maybe on animal and anything related to that. But there's not been a co-occurrence. And then in 1987, but the researchers they find that this correlation, right? And then that's the first time that these two concepts, HIV and monkey, have been seen in the same publication, in the same paper. And that's how they define the innovation, because that's the first time they see the two concepts, and it is indeed a sort of a big step towards understanding where HIV comes from and how it works. So we sort of borrowed the idea, and we define software innovation as the first co-occurrence of two packages in the same project. And in the hackathon, we mostly focused on JavaScript projects. We plan to do that still, because there are a vast number of JavaScript open source projects, and we want to focus on that. And I guess I'll finish up here first. So so we are using Word of Code to gather this information, because Word of Code has this sort of data on package usage. So basically, they have the data on when, where, and who introduced different packages into different open source projects. So we will be collecting that data and put together and basically find the first co-occurrence of two packages in the same project and collect those as innovations. Yeah, so like I said, in the hackathon, we collected only up to 2014. We plan to continue to do that up to present day. And then the open source, the Word of Code also has other data sets that we can use to help us identify all of the projects that a contributor have participated in for open source projects. So in that way, we can calculate some kind of a metrics for the contributor's open source career. And then finally, in terms of diversity, one good reason we chose to do the JavaScript project, focus on JavaScript project, is that we have diversity data from prior work for MPN registry projects, but also at the same time, we have innovations coming from all kinds of different JavaScript open source projects, not necessarily in the registry. We'll be collecting that from the Word of Code as well, because we can also find all of the contributors in all of these different projects. And then we will also need to collect and calculate tenure diversity. And then all of these diversity measures, they will be focused on groups, but our innovation will be focused on individuals. So eventually we will also calculate an individual-based metrics to represent how much an individual has exposure to diverse groups. And I believe that's it. Yeah. So I'll leave the screen on the study overview, and I'll take any questions. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Sam. Thoughts?
Yeah, I had a question. Sam, can you be a little bit more specific on the innovation data that you're pulling from the repositories? It kind of sounded like it was just the popularity of projects, but I don't think maybe I didn't understand it correctly.
Yeah, that's a good question. I guess so here I didn't really explain this very well, but for the innovation, so we are looking at the first co-occurrence of two packages in the same in any sort of JavaScript projects. So for example, you can have a request and I guess Lodash. These two are JavaScript packages, different JavaScript packages, and basically we are seeing which open source projects in the history of open source projects, JavaScript open source projects, is the first to use these two packages in their project. It's the first projects to ever do that. And the way we can calculate this information is that Word of Code basically has, they have the data of when, where, and who. So basically they have data of, I think they probably extracted that from maybe the code, but maybe more likely the package.json or the requirement list of projects for these projects. And they basically have that it's sort of like a giant database of for example in this particular project the package request has been introduced by whoever the author is in which commit. So they have that level of data, and that's why we can do this calculation. Yep.
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Any more live questions? Sam, I pasted some comments in the Zoom, but I'll just leave them there to not take up too much time.
Okay, yeah, sure.
And we could talk about this separately if you want.
Thank you.
All right, well, thanks.
Should I share my screen now?
Please, yes.
Okay. There we are. Right, so so my project proposal is on being trans in open source software, and this actually ties in very well with Sam's project. So yeah, I don't know if that was intentional or not, but nice. Okay, so for a little bit of background, open source software is growing in size and importance, especially very much recently. So in the past year, approximately 60 million project repos were added, which I think was more than like the past 10 years combined, something like that. And GitHub by 2025. So there's a lot of growth in this area. And so open source software is, you know, software that is free for anyone to use. So anyone can go in, participate, you know, take the code, fork a project and contribute. And so in theory, it should be, you know, a very open space because, like I said, anyone can contribute to it. Unfortunately, as far, you know, open source software has a bad history, especially with gender bias. So depending on the environment, about 1.5 to 5% of contributors are women. And this is compared to 28% of the industry overall. These numbers are a little outdated, but I think it's been held at these numbers for a while. Open source generally has a history of being unwelcoming to newcomers, mostly related to its history as lots of sort of mavericks, which were generally older white men who, you know, came in from computer science when it was first becoming a thing, and you know, they decided, oh, I want this code to be free, and so they created these very niche communities where it made it very difficult for newcomers to join, particularly women and other minority groups like Hispanics and Blacks, and so trans and non-binary people are especially vulnerable to personal attacks in tech. So Gamergate isn't a specifically open source example, but I think it's a good example of what people have to go through. So for those of you who aren't familiar, Gamergate was a situation where a trans woman advocated for I forgot exactly what it was. Sorry, I believe they advocated some for some sort of more inclusion. I think they wanted to introduce a code of conduct or something. And that essentially like escalated into like a bunch of people attacking her sort of position as a developer, questioning her reputation. And it got to the point where someone found her home address and posted it online. So that person was like forced to move, which is pretty extreme. And so that goes, you know, sort of hand in hand with open source in general. Even though there are a lot of trans people in the space that are quite visible. So like two important examples are Coraline at MK, who is the creator of the Contributors Covenant, which is one of the most widely used codes of conduct. And there's also Sage Sharp, who isn't trans, but non-binary. And they were a Linux developer who, I believe it was in 2015, but I could be wrong, they tried to introduce a code of conduct and Linus Torvalds responded with a code of conflict. And so they ended up dropping out of the project, even though they're one of the higher up developers. So in general, there's a lot of sort of toxicity going on specifically for this group. And sort of why I want to focus on, you know, specifically looking at trans and non-binary people is a good question, because according to the GitHub 2017 survey, they only make up like 0.3% of the developers. However, we're seeing that, especially amongst Gen Z, I don't know if you saw the like report from last week, but a lot more people are identifying as something other than cisgender. And we've seen some preliminary research from Bogdan, I think, and also some things that I've seen in my own studies where people will look at a project and their code of conduct and their culture and decide whether or not to contribute to that particular project. And on top of that, you know, the demand for developers is growing. So I believe the current gap is like 500,000 between supply and demand of developers, but that is estimated to grow to like 3.5 in the next 5 years. And so in order to meet that demand, we should be like working towards making sure that everyone feels comfortable joining open source and they're willing to stay, you know, to meet this demand. And so for my research questions, I'm curious how trans and non-binary individuals' careers progress in open source. So how they get into it, how do they decide what projects to contribute to, and how does their experience change after making their transition or change in, you know, gender publicly known? Are they treated any differently? Do they find support? Are they attacked? And going to attack, does that lead to early dropout rates amongst this group? And where do trans people find support within open source? Is there a community that they can sort of fall back on to find, you know, some sort of escape from toxicity within open source? And also, how do they change an idea? So do they create a new profile, or, you know, do they just change up some things, which Oliver Hameson has done some initial work on, which is really interesting, and it depends a lot on the website. So those are the things that I'm mostly interested in. And as far as my proposal plan, I'm planning on doing semi-structured interviews. I want to do this because I think it would allow for really rich and personal data as far as their experiences as a trans or non-binary person in open source. And, you know, I am aware that certain aspects, especially asking about their transition or any sort of like personal attacks, is a very sensitive topic. And so, you know, I'm working towards that with like, you know, reading up on the literature, reading some trans narratives, and also like consulting with a sort of trans researcher to make sure, you know, I go about it correctly. And yeah, so I'm curious, you know, about their backgrounds to see how they got into open source initially, how they choose the projects that they, you know, decide to contribute to, their overall experience, the good and bad, and yeah, how they reflected, how they sort of represented their online profile. And from these interviews, I'm hoping to develop a code book and yeah, eventually get to the point where I can see some interesting patterns come up and then analyze and present the results. Okay. Ta-da.
I actually have a question. So Yuwen was just here giving a job talk, and one of the things she studied was the differences between, at a high level, she was doing MRI scans of people, and one of the things she studied was differences between literally how men and women think and how their brain works. And she got a really good question about, did they look at trans or non-binary people? And mm-hmm. she said they tried, but the problem was they couldn't recruit enough people. I'm wondering mm-hmm. if you have considered this as a similar problem and what you might do to address this problem.
Yeah, so this study actually came about because I was interviewing, I was interested first in the career trajectories between men and women. And so there were so few women that, you know, it was kind of easier to sort of recruit them. Yeah, because there were so few. And it sort of came up just that, just like, just randomly. And I would like find out, like when I met them for the interview, they happened to be trans. And so I know, like, I think I had a fair amount of like trans interviewees that were unexpected. And they talked a lot about, you know, their issues with gender, which in open source, which spurred this whole study. And so as far as recruitment, it is a very small group. And so what I've been doing, because I just started last week recruiting, was speaking to those people and asking, do you know people? Is there a sort of like developer community that you're involved in? Because, you know, I don't have the resources to find that sort of thing. So the best way is sort of that snowball effect or word of mouth. So that's how I've been going around it so far.
Yeah, I think that'll work. I don't think she had enough time to really focus on this, but I think the snowball thing sounds a good idea.
Any more thoughts from the room? I thought the buildup was good, though probably you could have gone to the point a little bit sooner, faster. There was maybe a little bit too much rambling about like random trivia. That was all interesting, but you know, given the format here, so I would expect those things in a write-up, for example, more so than here, given the condensed format. I think the choice of method is correct. I would have done the same. You didn't say much about how you will identify participants, and Jeremy already asked about that. So that seems sort of a hard thing. The one other thing I had there is, what if anything is trans-specific here versus maybe applicable to all groups that are currently underrepresented in OSS? So that's something that you might want to articulate more clearly in the write-up.
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
It could be that, you know, that trans folks are the most overlooked population or group or something by researchers or something along these lines. Even if maybe the challenges or whatever experiences are shared with other folks too. Simon, CJ?
All right, share my screen. Okay. All right. So hello, everyone. So today, CJ and I are going to propose the ROS security project. So ROS is an open source meta program operating system for robots. It provides the most services you would expect from an operating system, including hardware abstraction, low-level device control, implementation of commonly used functionalities, message passing between processes, and package management. So over the years, ROS has provided a common framework for robotics applications. And because of this, ROS is heavily utilized by the research community for service robotics applications. I recently, due to its outstanding capability and simplicity, it has drawn tremendous attention from the industry and the government, who are trying to apply ROS to a wide range of security critical systems. However, the very creation of the ROS project is to prevent people from reinventing the wheels in robotics. It simply did not have security in mind. The ROS community has realized its deficiencies back in 2015 and started the development of the next generation ROS systems, ROS 2 and SROS, which stands for Secure Robotics Operating Systems. However, to our knowledge, SROS is currently highly experimental and under development, and most of the ROS-based systems are still written in the original non-secure version of the ROS system. So therefore, our work mainly interfaces with three group of target audiences, ROS application developers, ROS platform developers, and security researchers. So for the ROS application developers, especially the ones who work on security critical domains, such as medical robots, drones, autonomous vehicles, et cetera, we would like to provide guidelines for them on how to secure their systems from an architectural level. For the ROS platform developers and security researchers, we would like to provide advice on how to build their next generation security infrastructures, such as the SROS system or other security related functionalities. And we have coined three research questions based on our goals. So first, we would like to explore the architectural characteristics of different ROS-based projects categories by their domains. The follow-up questions we may ask are, what are the typical architectural pattern for domain? And what are the frequently used libraries for a particular domain? And what are their functionalities? Secondly, it's how to guide roboticists to secure ROS-based systems. And third, how to guide platform developers and researchers to develop future security frameworks, mechanism, infrastructures, and other reusable security components.
Yeah, right. So, okay. So we plan to conduct our research in three phases. So in phase one, we plan to collect architecture related data from representative open source ROS projects from different domains and from GitHub. And then second, we will use this data to generate guidelines from security experts. And finally, we plan to evaluate the guidelines we generate from phase two by using a survey. And also at the same time, we plan to use a survey asking questions like what kind of additional guidelines you have. And so we're also using this survey to elicit more guidelines. So next page. So in particular, like in phase one, so prior work has already collect a repository for open source ROS projects and also identify their domains. So we plan to use this existing data and to select kind of representative ROS projects from different domains. Second, we will manually or use some tool to extract the architecture related information, including their domain, their documentations, their actual architecture, their library use, and the functionality for the critical components in the system. So next page. Yeah, next page. Yeah, so no, sorry, phase two. Oh, okay. Yeah, so for phase two, we plan to use some things, for example, like threat model. So we have the architecture related data. So we can use tools like threat modeling to generate guidelines for how we can secure a system from architecture level. So for example, the result could be some actionable guidelines like you should encrypt certain connections or you should kind of isolate certain components in the system. Yeah, next page. So for phase three, after generating these guidelines, we plan to use our survey to evaluate the usefulness of our guidelines. And our target would be ROS application developers and also ROS platform developers and also security security related researchers. And also in this survey, as I mentioned, we also plan to ask the participants what kind of guidelines you have in mind. And yeah, I think that's what we have for this presentation. Yeah.
Thanks all. Questions, thoughts, ideas, feedback on the design?
Do you have any idea for like how many projects you're gonna try to look at? Like, is it gonna be a ton of them or is it gonna be like a smaller amount where you can do some like manual work?
So the prior work has a ROS-based system repository collection of 115. But we plan to select representative systems from each domains. And yes, we're planning on studying on like small set of maybe less than around 10 repositories and see if we can extract useful information from them.
Yes, so to add on that, so we we used to plan to kind of use some automatic tool to kind of extract architecture from a lot of projects, but it turns out that that tool is not stable enough right now. So we still have to manually do the process. So we turn out to be a kind of a more qualitative study.
All right, thanks all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
June, do you want to go next?
Can you see my screen? So I think I'm the outlier in this class. I think I'm the only one studying accounting and finance. So I tried to make it simple and easy to understand, but please let me know if you have any questions. So my research topic is related to retail investors or amateur investors' investment decisions, especially related to how they use accounting information when they're making decisions. So the reason why the reason that triggered my interest in this topic is the recent huge increase in the number of retail investors. There has been a number of reasons behind this, the pandemic lockdown and the advent of Robinhood, their free stock trading fees and easier trading platforms and the elevated stock prices recently, especially like to Tesla and stuff. And I think the number of Robinhood users represent this number, the number of retail investors. And I read an article that this number has increased to 20 million by this year. So before going on to the next slide, what represents a stock's value? It is basically equity ownership of a fraction of a company. So the value of company, such as the future cash flows of a company. And logically one should investigate the company's quantitative and qualitative accounting information to evaluate the value of a company. However, what I see is not that. And I guess I didn't explicitly state on this slide, but my theory is that investors are, or humans in general, are not logical, including myself. And so if you see on to the left of the slide, this is the accounting information. So GameStop is one of the representative stocks that the Wall Street Bets subreddit has chosen to rebel against the Wall Street hedge funds. So GameStop has been, the revenue of GameStop has decreased for the last few years, and the net income has, so they have been losing money in the last few years. And their credit rating has been downgraded in 2020 because they couldn't pay for their loans. However, the stock price has not been reflecting this trend. They have skyrocketed in the middle of, like towards the end of January. And obviously they came down, but in the last two days, it has increased by like 55%. But anyways, a ton of people who jumped onto the stock as it skyrocketed, they lost $167 billion from the Robinhood 50 stocks as of February 2nd. The importance of this study is that individual investors' attention to accounting information is of interest to academics, standard setters, and firms. Especially for standard setters, they spend a lot of resources on regulating accounting information, but if the retail investors are not using this information, then they should find other ways to spend their resources to protect the investors. So there are actually two gaps in the literature. There has been research on the frequency of like Google searches and or appearances in Twitter and or number of downloads on of financial filings, but there hasn't been enough research on the content of the information processed by individuals. And also even if they looked into the content of these information, they were limited to the communities such as Yahoo Finance, Twitter, or StopTwits, and they have not been looking into the Wall Street Bets subreddit, which has the most number of users. So my research questions are, here are two research questions. So first is, how and when do retail investors use accounting information when making investment decisions? I'm suspecting that a lot of these decisions are passion driven. So I would see that they are actually not using accounting information that much. And I can compare this to other previous platforms, their text data. And also I would like to investigate if the stock prices are more correlated to sentiment of the Wall Street Bets text rather than the accounting information itself. And to do this, I can do count the frequency of accounting firms mentioned in the Wall Street Bets subreddit. And I can compare the frequency of emotional vocabulary used in the Wall Street Bets subreddit versus other platforms. And I can conduct a correlation analysis to see the relationship between stock prices and the accounting and the subreddits versus the earnings information. Yep. I think that's it. Any questions?
Cool, thanks. Are there any confounding factors here or covariates besides the sort of two things you're interested in correlating directly?
What do you mean?
Like, is there anything else that could explain why there's a correlation? So let's say you detect some correlation between stock prices and sentiment. Is there something else that could detect that could explain that other than the construct you're interested in, which is that investors are not rational and they sort of make these passion-driven decisions?
I think because the value of a company should really come from how the actual company is doing, the more it deviates from the actual earnings or its financial status it proves that people are not rational, if that makes sense.
I guess, could you make that claim causally, or is there any other factor that you're maybe not measuring or observing that might explain that causal relationship or might affect it?
I think causal relationship is a little hard to investigate. I think it's just the correlation, because it's hard to investigate how these people actually think, like the process of their thoughts.
Right, I see. So you're not actually making any causal claims, you're just focusing on the correlation itself. Okay.
Right. I think in order to do that, I think I would need to conduct an experiment.
Yeah, cool. Thanks a lot. How about Ben next?
Right. Oh. Let me that thing. Okay. So my proposal's on exploring the efficacy of scenario-based testing in autonomous vehicle systems. So the first thing that we should kind of cover is just that safety is important. Generally, we want our systems to do things that are safe and not do things that are unsafe. In the world of autonomous vehicles, safety is very important because, you know, unsafe behavior of an autonomous vehicle can result in death, which is usually something that we very much want to avoid. Unfortunately, it's hard to be confident in autonomous vehicles' safety. this is due to a number of reasons. They operate in a complex unknown domain with a highly dimensional state space. Requirements are hard to specify. And because of the difficulty of specifying the requirements, there are often machine learning components, which are, as we know, unreliable. And at their core, they're just very complex systems. So there's a lot to kind of make you not be confident in these systems. But ultimately, you know, we have some confidence in them. Obviously, society has gained some confidence. They're, you know, on the street, people drive with them. They're supposed to be paying attention, but we know that people don't always pay attention. So we have some confidence in them. And there are steps along the way to gain confidence in the safety of these autonomous vehicles, like, you know, component level testing and verification. But ultimately, you know, you're going to be looking at system level testing. So observing the entire autonomous vehicle stack and seeing if it's doing the right thing to have like more confidence in the system as a whole. One of the more common ways of doing this kind of functional system level testing is what's known as scenario-based testing. It's a lot like what it sounds. You have some number of traffic scenarios where the car is trying to overtake another car, maybe a deer runs in front of the car. We have many number of these that we're testing. There's theoretically like an infinite number of scenarios to test. So obviously we have some sort of strategy to select certain scenarios to test. And then with each scenario, we want to see if any traffic violations or lane violations or crashes occur when you run that scenario. And so we're relying on some probabilistic idea that, you know, if something were wrong with our system, we would have seen it after running our system over some large number of scenarios. This is what our intuition would tell us. But we might want to investigate this a bit more. This is something that kind of previous research hasn't really investigated the assumptions behind scenario-based testing. And so specifically, I'm going to be looking at investigating what types of safety bugs can scenario-based testing identify and with what probability. Also, which scenario selection strategies are superior for identifying which kinds of bugs. And these are hard questions to answer because, you know, the domain is very complex. There are a lot of moving parts. But in recent years, there are these open source autonomous vehicle systems, which give us excellent case studies to actually analyze these research questions in an empirical way. So we have AutoWare and Apollo have a lot of historical bug data. They have all their commit logs over the years. And so we know what kind of bugs exist and which kind of components. And we can use this information to look at historical bugs and kind of answer these research questions from the context of our case studies. So now we can answer these questions in the context of AutoWare or in the context of Apollo and see if, you know, scenario-based testing is effective for certain classes of bugs and not for other classes of bugs, and then which components they're effective in and which components they're not effective in. So yeah, at a high level, safety is important in autonomous vehicles, and scenario-based testing is one way that we are currently gaining confidence in their ability. And with the advent of these large production level open source autonomous vehicle systems, we can use them as case studies to do some empirical research evaluating scenario-based testing strategies. That's everything.
Yeah, excellent. Super interesting. Thanks. Any thoughts?
I actually have it's probably I missed something, but I just want to ask, is this a human study or a study on human, or is it based, is a study on the algorithm itself? I think I'm not clear.
Yeah, sorry. It's so we're studying existing autonomous vehicle kind of software systems. We're using those as a case study to evaluate scenario-based testing. So there are no humans involved directly.
Okay. I was missing a little bit more detail on the data itself, you know, how many bugs and how are they identified and collected and how are you gonna analyze them? So just more, what does superior mean when you're sort of comparing things?
Yeah. So the autonomous vehicle bugs, they have a lot of them. We're focusing on behavioral bugs. So things that you'll see at runtime that you wouldn't see, like, so we're not including like build failures, that kind of thing. We haven't gone through all of them. There's this paper that I've included the title of at the bottom that has gone through and cataloged all the bugs and said like this bug, which they've scraped from the commit history, they can say like this bug is corresponds to like this component, and the symptom that you would see from this bug is maybe a trajectory error or maybe a stop error. So they've done a lot of the work for us, but we've been going through them, and not all of the bugs are usable for our contexts. So we'll probably have like something like 20 from AutoWare. Apollo, we haven't gone through yet.
Is that going to be enough to make claims about statistical significance or things like that? You know, just questions to, you don't have to answer now, but questions to think about as you're doing the write-up.
Yeah. I was trying to be more high level, but I guess I could have been a little bit lower.
Well, thanks, Ben. Jenna?
Yep, let me share my screen. Move you guys out of the way. Oops. Sorry, the bar is like, I gotta wait for it to go away so I can actually click at the top of the screen. Can I move it? Yes, I can. Okay. Okay. Sorry about the technical difficulties. All right. So hi, everyone. Today, I'll be talking to you about our current work in gradual verification in relation to prior work and our plans for evaluating aspects of gradual verification empirically. But first, I will start with what gradual verification is and why it's important. So consider that Jenny wants to ensure that her findMax function returns the maximal element of a list. So she specifies the post condition in red using the recursive Boolean functions max and contains, and applies a dynamic verifier to the code. As a result, max and contains are simply run after each execution of findMax. However, Jenny wants to make sure that max and contains are true for every execution of findMax. So for all the programs. But applying a static verifier to do this results in failure because such tools require many specifications. And in Jenny's case, she will need to specify a precondition, loop invariants, folds and unfolds, and lemmas as highlighted here in orange. Worse even is that she can't check if a single specification she writes like a loop invariant is correct without providing all the rest of the specifications. Instead, though, gradual verification is an approach that allows developers to incrementally build up correctness specifications and proofs without additional effort. Therefore, developers can focus on specifying and verifying the most important properties and components of their system and receive immediate verification feedback. And it'll give feedback either statically where it can, given the information that it has, or and then dynamically everywhere else to preserve soundness of the system. So now that I've hopefully sold you on gradual verification, I'm going to spend the rest of the talk describing our current and future gradual verification work. So the framework, like the very initial work in gradual verification was introduced by Bader et al. In 2018. While this work was promising, it was only applicable to very simple programs with very simple specifications. Therefore, in our current work, but previous paper in 2020, we extended Bader et al.'s work to support more realistic programs that contain recursive heap data structures, like lists, trees, and graphs. Even though this work was a significant step towards making gradual verification more usable in practice, it has significant limitations. First, definitions essential to the gradual verifier, such as the gradual weakest precondition rules, are defined very abstractly in support of our theoretical proofs. So, and then more implementable definitions have yet to be explored. And then second, the gradual verifier presented in our OOPS paper does not and cannot support eliminating dynamic checks using statically verified information. So for example, consider this graph, which shows the incremental buildup of the proof that a list remains acyclic after list insertion. And at 13 lines of specification code, the verifier checks 40% of the verification conditions statically. However, it will also check all of those verification conditions dynamically. So there's a lot of duplicate checking going on. And worse is that as you add lines of specification code and the verifier can check more things statically, it still checks everything dynamically. And so to overcome these limitations, we are in the process of designing and implementing a symbolic execution-based gradual verifier for recursive heap data structures. And a little bit about that. We build our gradual verifier on top of an existing static verifier called Viper because it supports recursive heap data structures through state-of-the-art techniques in static verification like implicit dynamic frames and abstract predicates. And it also has a really nicely documented accompanying PhD thesis, so that was a plus. But the most important part of Viper is that it's based on symbolic execution rather than weakest preconditions that I talked about before. And we found out that symbolic execution in particular is crucial for allowing us to eliminate those dynamic checks that was the limitation of our prior work. So that's why this was a really good target. And so after completing the implementation of our gradual verifier prototype, the fun part and the it's applicable to this class is we have plans to evaluate it theoretically and empirically. So theoretically, we just want to prove that our verifier design is sound, so it catches all the bugs and it adheres to the gradual guarantee, which is just one of our conditions that says you can hit like all those points on that graph before. More interesting is the empirical questions that we're going to ask, and I'll put those up and then talk a little bit about them. They're a little long, so I'm going to have them here for a while. So we want to explore the trade-off between static and dynamic checking in practice. This is something that hasn't been done before because no tool could support it. So the first research question is looking for trends in the percentage of verification conditions that are checked statically versus dynamically as lines of specification code vary. And the other one is looking for trends in the time it takes to dynamically verify programs as we vary lines of specification code. And so to answer these questions, we plan to collect correctly specified student code from CMU's 15-122 course, which teaches dynamic verification. And we also by hand generate specification increments along a smooth spectrum for instructor code solutions. And with these two sets of code samples, we'll use our gradual verifier to analyze them and collect a subset of data for each sample. So the first data point will be whether the sample was correctly verified as a sanity check for our implementation. Three more data points that we'll collect is the number of verification conditions checked statically, dynamically, and in total to answer research question one, and the time it takes to complete dynamic verification to answer research question two. And then finally, we'll aggregate and display this data across sample groups to explore resulting trends. And I'm a little over time, so I just have a quick summary that I had planned, but I won't go into that because that's basically my proposal. And I'll go back to the research questions because I think they're probably the most interesting.
Thanks, Jenna. Any thoughts? To me, the empirical component makes sense here, but I think the talk was maybe geared at a different audience. So I guess you're sort of reusing this from SSSG or something. So I, you know, I was expecting a little bit more intuition and a little bit more focus on the empirical component, and maybe a little bit less detail about the you know, technical details of the verifier for this audience.
Yeah, that makes sense. I really did try to tone it down, but I know that some of it was about, well, yeah, I guess I probably could have eliminated like slide 9, for example, which was the one about the actual like verifier implementation and like why we chose to do what we did. Some of the other slides, I wanted to kind of build up more of the background information to give context to the questions and the limitations of prior work, which we tried to answer in our current work and the study. But I guess the study got a little bit, as I changed the questions around, that got off track from the limitations and more kind of its own thing. So yeah, I could see where I went too heavy on the other stuff and not enough on the empirical side.
CJ?
Yeah, so I have a question. So if you only like using the program from the 15.1.22 course, that will you have kind of a coverage error for your study?
Yeah, so that's something we're worried about. Like I realized some might be an issue. It definitely won't be too generalizable to like more code used in practice because it's code used in kind of a more intro CS course. And sorry, I got distracted by the poll that just went up. Yeah, I think the coverage will, I might switch to actually using a data set from that some other static tools have used to evaluate their tools, which is more representative of code use in industry. But they're usually like not too large to do stuff with, and then stick to just lab generated specifications, just because like no incremental specifications exist in the wild because this is like a new thing. So your concern is valid, and I think that I will change my data sets to address that concern is the TLDR on that one.
Thanks, Jenna. The poll results are in. I think we're waiting for, okay. So the Thursdays have it. We'll start on Thursday with the last two talks. So Kyle and Bobo, let's maybe not keep folks over now because they might have other commitments. Sorry about the timing. We'll start with you on Thursday and then continue with your usual lecture. Okay. Please submit your slides. I open the Canvas thing. So I'll give you more feedback on that on the slide deck, just as a PDF. All right. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for the presentations. Good job with all of these.
Thank you.